morning. Amen. Easter people, we are Easter people. We live Easter every day, not just on Sunday a couple weeks ago, but every day for us is Easter because we serve and we worship, we praise, we love a risen Christ, and we follow Jesus in his way to live our lives. This morning, before we begin with our normal time of announcements and centering and stuff, I would like to just acknowledge and offer prayer and silence for those who were killed on Friday morning at FedEx. And we're used to hearing about mass shootings all over the country, but not so close to home. And unfortunately, it has affected us and our community. And so I think we should remember those who have passed, those who were killed, the families of those, and even remember the family of the shooter, who were struggling. All people are struggling to know why and how, and how can this be avoided again. But this morning, I want to light a candle in remembrance of those who are near to us in our community as we remember and take a moment of silence to remember them. Will you join me in a moment of silence this morning? Oh God, we may not know the people whose lives have been taken. We don't know the families that are represented by this tragedy. We may not know the coworkers who are suffering loss of friends, but we know that there is suffering. There are questions. There's anger. There's sadness. And we know that you are greater than any violence that exists in our world. You are greater than any pain that might be experienced, even the pain of losing a loved one. Lord, we ask that you would offer comfort and peace to those who are suffering the loss of friend and family today. In Jesus' name, amen. Last week I shared with you a little bit about the direction that the leadership team is going with the now structuring around Speedway now, and I wanted to just bring that up again, and I will for the next few weeks, just to keep this in front of us, because I want you to be thinking about these things and how you might fit into these areas. I'm not going to read word for word like I did last week. You can see what's up there, and just kind of give you a brief idea that the now is nurturing, how we care for our church family, and outreach is the O, and that's how we care for our community and our world, and witness is how we expand our church family, how we expand the kingdom of God, not just our church family, but the kingdom of God here on earth. And so I just want you to be thinking, go ahead and go to the next slide, the different ways that these areas of nurture, outreach, and witness play out in our church. These may be things that you've been involved in before. Maybe you've been a Sunday school teacher. Maybe you've worked with helping during worship. Maybe you've done things with small groups or some of these other areas that go together into make how we nurture and care for one another in our church and outreach. Go to the next one. Maybe you've been involved before in one of these areas in doing some ministry to the community or statewide or national or worldwide, and you have some experience with that and would like to get plugged back in. And witness has to do with, again, growing the kingdom of God, and has to do with how we present ourselves to the world. Maybe that's something of interest to you as well. And the idea is that all of us are gifted, right? The Holy Spirit is gifted, each and every one of us, with gifts and talents and abilities. And we are to use those gifts and talents and abilities to work together to nurture, to do outreach, and to witness, to grow the kingdom of God. So we all have a place where we can fit in to do one of these areas of ministry. And the way we carry this out, go ahead and go to the next one, is through resourcing our ministries through resource staff, which comes through the SPRC, the trustees, and the finance. And next one. And so maybe you've served on staff parish relations before. Maybe you've have some experience with in your job outside of the church with doing job description, writing job descriptions, and doing evaluations, ways that we can develop personnel and support pastor and personnel so that ministry can be done effectively. And trustees, maybe you like to cut grass. I'm not one of those people, but you might be. Maybe you're handy. Maybe you like to do things around your house be interested in doing some things that would help to maintain our church property, or to find the appropriate people who could do those kind of things. So that might be an area that you're interested in. Another area then is the finance. Go ahead, next one, where we look for ways that we can finance everything that we do, that we can not just pay salaries, not just keep the electric paid, not just keep the doors to the physical building open, but ways we can do the ministry that we're called to do, the ways we can continue to nurture outreach and witness. So those are all things that fit together in becoming the leadership team. Go ahead, next. And the leadership team will, do I not have a next one? There it is, okay. So the leadership team, the ministry team, and the worship resource team work together to be the leadership team of this church. They're the ones that set the course, that chart the course for the church. But we need all of you to be a part of that, working together. It's not just up to the leadership team to do all the work of the church. The leadership team is the where we figure out what our calling is, what it is we're going to do, how we're going to fill out the mission of making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. So those are how we kind of do the things that we do when we meet. We discuss these things, we plan these things, but we need you to figure out where you fit in and how you can help to do the things that we do together as a church. There is a leadership team meeting on Tuesday evening for those of you who are part of the leadership team. Just a reminder for that. And as we meet Tuesday evening to continue our planning for the year, the rest of the year to come, and for the future. So you'll be given an opportunity in a few weeks. We'll keep this coming before you and let you know in a few weeks on Pentecost Sunday when we talk about the birth of the church and what the church is about. And and what we're supposed to be doing, and we'll have a way for you to kind of plug in to how it is that we do ministry here at Speedway during this time of restructuring and refiguring who we are in light of this pandemic that we're on our way coming through, but we still have time to go. So ministry will be different now than it was possibly in the past. So keep the leadership team and in your prayers. And this morning then, as we begin for our time of worship, I invite you to just calm your mind. Be aware of where you are. Be aware that you're in this place, that you are in the presence of God. And close your eyes if you would like to or not. Just take a couple deep breaths. And breathe in the peace of God and exhale confusion. And inhale the peace of God and exhale fear. Inhale peace. And exhale grief. Inhale peace. And exhale doubt. Oh God, meet us in this room, in this place, at this time, as we are, and grant us peace. Amen.
Oh,
Scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, and it's kind of Luke's version of what we read about last week in John. Last week was John's version of Jesus appearing in that locked room. Remember that we read about last week, those of you who are here or joined us Facebook last week. This week, it's a similar story, probably the same instance, but it's Luke's take on it. And Luke doesn't emphasize the locked room as much as John did, but he does contain the elements of being in a room and being in there, and they're there, the disciples are there, and Jesus isn't there, and then the disciples are there, and Jesus is there, and they don't know how Jesus got there, and there's this idea of peace being extended to the disciples from Jesus, and this whole scenario is playing out again in a different way, with a little bit different outcome. And so we'll take a look at that this morning from Luke chapter 24, verses 36 through 48, the last part of verse 36 through 48. While they were talking about this, Jesus stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." And they were startled and terrified and thought they had seen a ghost. And he said to them, "Why are you frightened?" "Well, if I saw a ghost, I think I'd be frightened." That's what they were thinking, right? They thought they saw a ghost. And Jesus says, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet and see that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." I'm not a ghost. I'm not something that you can just imagine is here. I'm really here. I am present in the flesh. Touch me. And while he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything to eat?" So here we have a sense of joy, not just the doubt that was there before in John's telling of the story, but we actually read that there's joy. They're happy to see their friend again. They know that he's there, that they're not just imagining things. Jesus is really there. And then Jesus goes a step further and says, "Do you have something to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. I'd like to see a ghost do that. And then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things." When Jesus appeared to the disciples, he offered his nail-scarred hands and feet as proof that he was indeed the risen Lord. Then he ate in their presence. And "Lord, we are living in a world that behaves as though you never lived. Our eyes behold atrocities and insults that we never thought possible and that our grandparents thought they would never see again. We live in a world that is longing for proof of the resurrection, proof of the living Lord. Lord, show us how to prove your living through our lives. Put our hands to doing what you would have done were you still on this earth. Place our feet on a path that leads others to salvation. Pull us out of our caves of isolation so that we might be seen as ordinary, living, breathing, caring people. living, the resurrection, Easter people. When the people of the land cry out for proof that you are alive, or even that you ever existed, may we be able to offer our hands and our feet and our lives as that living proof. Amen. Ghosts. Ever hear a good ghost story? There's a series of books, maybe you've heard of it, called Haunted Indiana. There's five of them. Those were written by a now retired United Methodist pastor. I'm not going to tell you who he is because he writes under a pseudonym. His name, his author's pen name is Mark Merriman. But he has written 5 books about different hauntings and stories just in Indiana, haunted Indiana. And I'm sure you're all familiar with the ghost tours that they do downtown and all these kind of things that kind of fascinate us about this unknown part of our world where we have ghosts and think that ghosts are there. And whether you believe in ghosts or not, there's a lot of people that do and have experiences with ghosts and hauntings and whatnot. And maybe you do, and maybe it's one of those things that you don't like to talk about because people might think you're a little woo-hoo. Or they might think, uh-oh, maybe he's not really a Christian if he thinks that there's ghosts because the Bible doesn't tell us what we're supposed to think about ghosts. It's true, the Bible doesn't tell us what we're to think about ghosts and all of that. But, you know, there are people that you know and that I know who have stories of inexplicable things, right, that happen. A friend of mine, his name's Chris. He's a good friend of mine from high school. I remember him telling me one time about shortly after his brother, Tom, committed suicide, like within a week after that happened, he was laying in bed, and he was sharing a room with his other brother at the time, Tori was his name, and Chris and Tori were sleeping, and Chris said that while he was in the bedroom, he wasn't sleeping, but they were sharing the room together, excuse me, and he was laying in bed, and he knew he wasn't asleep, and he all of a sudden saw his rocking chair in that room start rocking, and he was aware of the sound of it before he saw it, and when he looked over and saw it, he saw his brother Tom was sitting in the chair rocking. Now, he was like the disciples were when they thought they saw it. He was scared. What is going on here? And he remembers Thomas being there, but then as he became more aware of Tom's presence, he felt a little bit more at peace with his passing and realized that he was okay. Well, in the morning, he went down and told his mom what had happened. And Mom sat there and listened. She said her eyes were just really big, and he thought, well, she believes this, she believes my story. She's, this is some kind of confirmation. And then when he got done, she looked at him and said, "What are you and Tori up to?" Remember his other brother. So Tori just came down and told me the exact same thing. Now, Chris and Tori didn't speak about it. They each thought they had this experience all on their own. Come to find out, they were both awake. They both saw the rocking chair. They both saw Thomas. And they both told Mom. Whether that proves there's ghosts or not, I don't know. But you hear these kind of things time and time again, don't you? And the Bible doesn't tell us what to think about ghosts. But that shouldn't come as a surprise. The Bible doesn't tell us what to think about a lot of things, does it? I mean, the Bible has no explicit teaching on cars or computers, cell phones, magazines, anime, rock and roll music, the correct way to hang toilet paper. I mean, there's just some things the Bible doesn't discuss and doesn't tell us about. And, when you stop and think about it, though, even if the Bible did say something about some of those things, it probably wouldn't really matter much anyway, because we'd go on continuing to believe what we believe about X, Y, and Z, whether the Bible supports it or not. right? I mean, we all have a tendency to pick and choose those parts of the Bible that seem important to us and support what we want to believe in. Don't believe me? Think you're above that? What are you wearing this morning? You check the tag on your clothing this morning? Is what you're wearing 100% cotton? Is it 100% wool? Is it 100% anything? Is it mixed? Is it 90% this and 10% that? Is it 80, 10, and 10? I mean, what was the makeup? What, look at your label when you get home today. What was the, if you didn't look at it already, which I'm sure we didn't, what is the makeup of your clothing? Because if it is anything other than 100% one material, shouldn't wear it. That's what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us in various places. We'll just look at Leviticus. Chapter 19. It says, "You shall keep my statutes. You shall not let your cattle breed with a different kind. You shall not sow your field with two kinds of seeds, nor shall you wear a garment made of two kinds of material." Deuteronomy. "You shall not wear cloth of wool and linen mixed together." Again in Deuteronomy. "A woman shall not wear a man's garment, or shall a man put on a woman's cloak, for whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord." Men's clothes and women's clothes. Now, I'm assuming we take that to mean, you know, pants, and pants would be men's clothes, and women's clothes would be skirts or dresses. But they all wore the same kind of clothing, the same kind of tunics, the same kind of wraps. They wouldn't have that distinction. So there's another type of distinction there. Or in Ezekiel, when they enter the gates of the inner court, they shall wear linen garments. They shall have nothing of wool on them. Anybody wearing 100% linen this morning? We're at the gates. We're in the inner court. We're in the presence of God. They shall have linen turbans on their heads. Not a turban in the place. And linen undergarments around their waist. I won't check that one. You're on your own. And they shall not bind themselves with anything that causes sweat. Well, I guess I should take this off. But how many of you could say you consulted the Bible before you got dressed this morning? First Corinthians chapter 11 tells us that women should have their heads covered. I don't see any women with faces covered, don't count. Scripture tells us that women shouldn't speak in church. Scripture tells us that women shouldn't be in a position of authority over men. Scripture tells us that women should, you know, Scripture has a lot to say about women shouldn't do. There's a lot to say about what's permissible and impermissible for women, but let's not go into all that today. Let's just realize that there are things in Scripture that we listen to and heed, and some things we don't. Consider your diet. Genesis 9, chapter 1, verse 29 says, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit, and you shall have them for food." There you go. Genesis 1. We should all be vegetarians. Genesis 9, well, every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And I gave them, and I gave you the green plants, I give you everything. So everything that moves, so now it's okay to eat animals a few chapters later. It's okay to eat everything. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. Then in Leviticus, the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, saying to them, speak to the people of Israel, saying, these are the living things that you may eat among the animals that are on the earth. Whatever parts the hoof and is cloven-footed and chews the cud among the animals, you may not eat. Nevertheless, among those that chew the cud or part the hoof, you shall not eat these. The camel, because it chews the cud but does not part the hoof, is unclean to you. Whew. I haven't eaten any camels. I'm good. The rock badger, because it chews the cud but does not part the hoof, is unclean to you, and so on and so forth. And the pig, because it parts the hoof and is cloven-footed but does not chew the cud, is unclean to you. Don't eat it. Now I'm going to ask for a show of hands of who had bacon this morning. But see, there's things that we take as laws and rules to follow, and things that we don't. And that's why you can have so many discussions with so many different people, when people have different ideas and different interpretations, because they're focusing on one verse other than another. I might be a vegetarian and say, I base that on Genesis 1 through 9. Well, you might say, well, I eat everything, and I base that on Genesis 9. And someone else might say, well, I can't eat cows and pigs because they chew cud or have cloven hooves. And you know what? You're all right. So, getting back to this particular point, when we can believe in something or support something, and we can always find verses in the scripture that will back it up. That's why there's so many different denominations. So just because the ghost or the Bible doesn't say anything about ghosts, and even if it did, as I said, it probably wouldn't matter, because we'd still go right on believing what we believe anyway. But we do know concerning ghosts in the Bible that they did believe in them, right? In our scripture reading this morning, ghosts are mentioned twice, once from the disciples and once from Jesus. And that's not the only time that ghosts are mentioned in the New Testament. Remember when the disciples saw Jesus walking to them on the sea? They were afraid because they thought a ghost was approaching them. And they cried out in fear. But in both of those occasions, Jesus assured them that he is neither a ghost nor an apparition of some sort, that he is, in fact, real. And that's the point. That's the lesson we learn from this, is that Jesus is real. Whether in his earthly body before the crucifixion and resurrection or after the resurrection, Jesus is real. And sometimes we need, and the world needs, to see that real Christ, that real presence of Jesus in the world, in order to believe. That it's not enough to just talk about it. It's not enough to just say to somebody, I believe in Jesus. It must be real in order to be believed. Words can be empty. Our actions can speak volumes. Our actions are what can show whether Jesus is real or not. Is Jesus really alive in the world today? Yes. And it's our responsibility, it's our duty, it's our God-given task to show others that Jesus is real. That's why we talk about the church being the body of Christ, the body of Jesus. We talk about being the hands and the feet of Jesus, and that is so we can make real Jesus in the world today. It's not just something that we idly chit-chat about when we come to church on Sunday mornings or attend Bible studies. It's something more than we give lip service to. It's something we give our heart service to. Something that we give our lives to. The letter from James in the New Testament. Remember the passage where James says that you have to have, that faith without works is dead. You have to have works. You can't just have faith by itself. You can't say to somebody, be at peace, and not feed them if they're hungry. You can't say one thing and do another. You can't tell someone to be at peace and then leave them with an empty stomach. Where's the peace in that? What we say and what we do must match. It must be one and the same. And that is the way that we represent Jesus to the world, because what we say carries very little weight. Those of you who have friends who are not followers of Jesus know that your words mean very little to them. But what you do demonstrates the love of God more than any words that you speak. They must go together. We can't, like James says, we can't say God loves you and then turn our backs on our neighbors. It doesn't work that way. For when we say that, it's almost as like we're denying that we are Easter people. That we are denying the fact that we are to be living the resurrection. We are to be living examples of the risen Christ. We can't say that we care for our community and do nothing about the evils that plague our communities. We can't say that we care for our neighbors and do nothing about hunger and homelessness, gun violence, addiction, human trafficking, and the list goes on and on and on. We can't just send thoughts and prayers to victims of gun violence, to our neighbors experiencing loss from FedEx this week. Prayers and thoughts are a start. But what we say and what we do must be unified. Oftentimes, we ourselves are the answers to our own prayers. When we pray for there to be peace in our neighborhoods, peace in our community, how do we think that's going to happen? By the people of God rising up and becoming the hands and feet of Christ. God's not just going to do a flyover and drop peace in the community. God's not going to just drive up and down our streets and shower every home with peace and love. That's what we're for. We shower our communities with peace and love. Now, I don't know what that looks like in light of FedEx shooting this week. I don't know what we can do. I know that if we pray for God to lead us in what we can do, how we can make God real in the lives of those families that are hurting, that God will show us what we can do. At the very least, we can send thoughts and prayers. At the very least, we can still continue to be the light in our community that God calls us to be. Remember, Jesus is the light of the world. And we are his hands and feet. We are his presence in the world. So we must be that light in this world of darkness. Our words and our deeds must work together to keep the light glowing brightly, to keep Jesus alive. We, as followers of Jesus, must be real, tangible. Things that people can touch, and examine, and see, and experience in real, true, meaningful ways. Not just empty platitudes. As individuals, we must be real. A real experience for others to know Christ. And as a church, we must be real. We must be seen. And we must be present. Amen. Today and always, as you leave this place, taking that peace into the world so that others may know the peace of Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let heavens roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival.
Heaven's roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival.
Heaven's roar and
fire fall. Shake the ground with the sound of revival.
My God, he's surely alive.
He's living on the inside.